name is Caroline Rees. I'm the president of SHIFT, a non-profit center for business and human rights practice, and it's really a great pleasure indeed to welcome you all here this evening. I was just remarking to Philip Alston the sign by the door that says that the legal capacity of this room is 160 people, but he assures me we have enough lawyers in the room to make a good case if we should exceed that nevertheless. And so a warm welcome to everyone. Great to have you with us. I guess I should just logistically at the beginning ask people to please, if you haven't already done so, switch your phones on to silent or vibrate or whatever, just to avoid too many musical accompaniments through the rest of the evening. And to let you know, we are filming this evening's event and there'll be some photographs taken, so I hope nobody's feeling camera shy, but we wanted to have a record of the event as well. In the event that it's needed, bathrooms are down the hall by the clock, so that you know, and exits in the case of need, three places around this room. So much for the logistics. Obviously, we're here today to celebrate the United States launch of John Ruggie's new book, Just Business, which, as you all know, is the story, essentially, of his mandate as the UN Secretary General's Special Representative for Business and Human Rights, a journey of 6 years from 2005 to 2011, when the UN Guiding Principles on Business and Human Rights, the product of those 6 years of work, were published. And so this book tells the story of progress through that time, the process and the substance of what took place. It really is, in many ways, an incredible journey. I think back myself to 2004, the year before John was appointed by Kofi Annan, when I was a representative of British government in the United Nations, and this subject of business and human rights landed on our agenda. And I recall very clearly, as the UK representative, having British industry in one ear, very vocally protesting that it was absolutely unacceptable that business should be made the proxy for government and that governmental responsibilities for respecting, protecting, and fulfilling human rights should be foisted upon business. And very vocally in the other ear, British civil society organizations saying it's absolutely unacceptable that serious business impacts on workers and communities around the world should carry on without adequate accountability. And the challenge to us as governments was that they were both absolutely right. But we lacked the material to connect these two discourses. Enter John Ruggie. 2005, Kofi Annan appointed John as his special representative to try and do just that, try to take those very challenging ingredients and cast a way forward that could actually contribute to the debate. And that's what he did. As the blurb on the book about the book says, in a way, John's mandate is a lesson in, and I quote, how to navigate the tricky processes of global problem solving and consensus building, and how to tackle big issues with ambition, pragmatism, perseverance, and creativity. And I know John would add the word principled before pragmatism as well in that listing. So it's really a moment of pride for SHIFT as an organization to co-host the launch of this book, because in a way, the story of the book is also, to an extent, the story of our organization. We're a team of people that work closely through those years with John on the development of the guiding principles and everything that went before them, whether on his core advisory team or in specific projects and pilots that shaped up the various parts of the content. I'm delighted also that we have two other members of the family of his team with us this evening, Gérald Pachou and Christine Bader. It's terrific to have them here as well. Of course, the guiding principles were not the end of the story, and they weren't intended to be the end of the story. That would all be too neat and too simplistic. They're a means to the end, and of course, the end remains the improvement of the realization of human rights for workers and communities around the world who are impacted by business activities. And so it was in light of that that some of us decided with John to go on and form a non-profit organization to be part of the next stage of implementing the guiding principles. And we formed SHIFT as an organization that works today with governments, with businesses, with civil society organizations, international organizations, professional associations, and others on various aspects of this, frankly, huge agenda. I'll say in that light, outside the door, two of our reports just published this week as an illustration, one on meaningful stakeholder consultation in Myanmar, a big new market, of course, that many companies are looking at going into if they're not already, and a discussion paper on the development of global reporting and assurance standards on alignment with the UN guiding principles. So two of the pieces of work we've been doing in recent months. So that's SHIFT. We are thrilled to be co-hosting this evening with two other organizations. First, the Business and Human Rights Resource Center, and I suspect there are few in the room who have not heard of it, and if you haven't, then you have now, and you need to, because this really is the Bible, the lifeline for anybody who works in the field of business and human rights, an organization that conveys information about all the relevant developments with real balance, rigor, and integrity. So we're thrilled to have the Business and Human Rights Resource Center as our co-hosts, as we are thrilled to have our physical hosts, the Center for Human Rights and Global Justice here at the NYU School of Law, joining us in this event. The School of Law itself is the top-ranked international law program in the United States, and the center is doing leading academic and clinical work. Indeed, says on its website that it interrogates the human rights field from a critical perspective. And perhaps that gives a flavor of what it is that you have in store for you this evening. Because what we decided to construct was really a bit of a conversation for you and with you about the book and about its topic, no doubt with some critical moments there, as well as all good grist to the mill. And we'll do that through a panel discussion with the people you see up here. So let me introduce our cast of characters. I'll start with Philip Alston at the far end. Philip is going to moderate the conversation this evening. Philip is the co-chair of the Center for Human Rights and Global Justice. He's really a preeminent international human rights lawyer, and just one of many indicators of that is the range of top-level United Nations human rights positions he's held, most currently a special rapporteur on extrajudicial summary and arbitrary executions. He's also, I should say, a member of SHIFT's board, which we're extremely proud of, and he helps keep us on the straight and narrow in our work. On our panel, of course, I'll start with John Ruggie. Needs a little further introduction, I think, at this point. Before coming to his role, though, as the special representative of the Secretary General, he was, during Kofi Annan's first term as Secretary General, his strategic advisor, and is also very much the godfather of the Millennium Development Goals, and also closely involved in the creation of the Global Compact. We also have Gail Kell with us this evening from the Global Compact, and the co-father of that. He's also, of course, a professor of human rights and international affairs at the Harvard Kennedy School and chair of the board of SHIFT. Delighted that we also have with us Zoe McMahon from Hewlett-Packard. Zoe is the director of global social and environmental responsibility, and has really been taking over years a leading role from within a company about thinking of some innovative ways of tackling the complex issues of human rights in global supply chains, whether it be in the level of conflict minerals right at the bottom of those supply chains, or in the many tiers through the supply chains where workers' rights are so often in jeopardy. Zoe's also involved in various fora that look with business or in multi-stakeholder combinations at ways to tackle challenges in global supply chains. Mike Posner on my right will be, I think, well known as well to many of you, perhaps most recently, until very recently, in his role as Assistant Secretary of State for the Bureau for Democracy, Human Rights and Labour from 2009 under the Obama administration. And prior to that, for over 30 years with Human Rights First, a leading New York human rights advocacy organization. What you may not know is that he is now actually the Professor of Business and Society at the NYU Stern School of Business, and is working to build the very first Center on Business and Human Rights at a business school. So this is really a fascinating development, and although I guess, Mike, I would not wish competition upon organizations that are barely starting, I hope it will not be long before there are indeed other business schools that are as prescient.
That's the idea.
Right. And last and by no means least, I come to Chris Avery. I've mentioned already the Business and Human Rights Resource Center and their seminal work. Chris is not only the director of that center, he was also the founder of that center, and over the last 11 years has done extraordinary work to build it into what it is today, based in the UK and yet based everywhere, with teams on every continent doing really seminal work in this area. Previously, he was an international human rights lawyer and advocate, including with Amnesty International's International Secretariat. So that's our cast for the evening. Philip will lead a conversation first up here on the panel, amongst the panelists, and then after about 30 minutes or so, opening it up to you on the floor. We will have a microphone and we'll be asking people, I apologize, but it's the easiest thing to come to the mic to ask a question, make a comment, be part of the conversation for another 30 or so minutes before we then invite you all to a reception and, of course, the inevitable book signing as well. So with that, be welcome. Fabulous to have you here. And Philip, let me hand over to you.
Oops. Thanks, Caroline. It's true, this microphone's at a rather odd angle. All right. So welcome to everyone. Thanks to Caroline. It's great to have had the chance to work on the board of Shift and to be following up on John's work. I should begin immediately by thanking my colleagues from the Centre for Human Rights and Global Justice who have done an enormous amount of work to get all of this together. And thanks to Chris Avery and the others as well. What we want to do tonight, I think, is to have a conversation around John's book, around his work. I have to confess immediately that I am ill-disposed towards John. he and I were mandate holders, so-called, of the UN Human Rights Council at around the same time. And for whatever reason, we found ourselves back-to-back on several occasions. John Ruggie up there presenting his guiding principles and so on, governments throwing boxes of chocolates and kisses and hugging him in all directions, and then followed by me with all of the brickbats and abuse that came, and the contrast was almost too much for me to handle. Fortunately, none of the government said what they were really thinking was, which was something like, Alston, why can't you be like Ruggie? But I want to begin, first of all, just with a very quick celebration, not to get it out of the way, although that's part of it, to say that no UN Human Rights Council mandate holder, to use the technical term, ever achieved as much as John did. No one took it as seriously as he did. No one has been turned into a full-time professional in such a role. John made himself into that. He raised money at a level that no other mandate has ever dreamed of, and he used that money with exceptional wisdom and so on to produce a consensus document, basically, that transformed the field that he entered. And that is an extraordinary achievement. I don't want our conversation to just be patting John on the back. He gets enough of that. and I hope we'll answer some of the tough questions. Before we get into the tougher ones, though, I would like to ask John to lead off just with a couple of comments, maybe telling us what the main message is. If I can start getting tough, the question to end with is your greatest failing in the mandate. But you can start with some nice comments.
Do I stay here?
Yeah.
Well, the biggest failing, thank you very much, first of all, for your very kind words and everyone else, Caroline, the whole gang who worked with me, and not only as members of my team, but like Chris and Mike and Zoe, who participated in the process and contributed immensely. None of this would have been possible without all of those, and John Sherman sitting right here. He was he was the real lawyer in the group. He actually has made a living being a lawyer for many years. I'm delighted that you've organized this. I never thought of the project as a destination. From the very first day, I described it as a journey, but a journey that needed a true north, because otherwise it would wander all over the place and not add up to very much. My take on the main message of the book, it's actually the title of chapter 2, which is No Silver Bullet. If there were an easy way to resolve the problem of sovereignty, of competitive markets, of greed, et cetera, and if I had a magic wand, I would have waved it. But lacking a magic wand, what I wanted to do was to try to put into place a new regulatory, a new approach to regulatory thinking about business and human rights. When I entered the scene in 2005, the debate was at an utter stalemate. You had, on the one hand, activist groups who somehow believed that negotiating an international treaty on business and human rights was one, feasible, and two, would solve the problem. On the other side, you had business and business associations who felt that essentially that voluntarism itself would eventually move markets, and there was no common ground among them. Governments, I once described very early on in my mandate, at that point in time, were spectators at a tennis match, watching two other players hit the ball back and forth across the net and not getting engaged.
Into the net.
Or into the net, yes. So the what do I consider to be the book's main message? There is no silver bullet. What I tried to do, as you well know, and we can certainly go into greater detail, is actually to draw on very different rationales that apply to the different major actors involved. So we have states, we have businesses, and we have civil society. The framework that we first introduced in 2008 and the guiding principles that so-called operationalize it spoke to states in the language of legal obligations. You created the international human rights regime. When you ratify a human rights treaty, you take on legal obligations. Here is what those legal obligations mean in terms of business and human rights. And here are some policy measures that are supportive and would reinforce what you ought to be doing in relation to those legal obligations. That was the discourse addressed to states. The discourse addressed to business was, you have an independent responsibility to manage the risk of contributing to adverse human rights impacts, irrespective of whether states do their job or not. It is in many cases in your own interest to do so. As we've seen over and over again in many sectors, because adverse impacts on human rights impact on people's human rights often lead to pushback by the people who are adversely affected, which in turn can harm companies. And the idea of human rights due diligence grew out of that framing. So you have a legal obligations framing addressed to states. You have a risk management, as it were, a discourse addressed to businesses. Lastly, affected people, communities, and NGOs who speak to them, who speak for them. There, the discourse drew on the need to more fully realize the right to remedy, to empower people further in demanding remedy, whether it is judicial or non-judicial. Now, the trick was to combine those three discourses in a single normative framework and then produce policy guidance for each of these actor or stakeholder groups to follow up on. That's the core message of the thing. The greatest failing, we're not there yet, but we're making progress. And I wish I had a magic wand.
No real failing? No, nothing that if you had another year you might have been able to do, or?
If I had another year, I would have collapsed.
Okay. Zoe, have the guiding principles made a difference to business? Or is it business as usual with a nicer gloss?
So I think I've been very fortunate to have been part of business during the time period that is relevant for this discussion, and to be able to observe some changes both before and after the guiding principles. So I'll speak a little to that. And the book speaks to this as well, that starting in the 90s, you had a period of rapid globalization, outsourcing, especially in supply chains. And along with that came some challenges and some human rights impacts that have been widely publicized in many industries. During that time, and for my sins, I've only ever worked for HP. I started in the environmental domain, and it grew into the human rights domain a little later. I was observing my interest in my career has always been about advancing and understanding the role of business in society and making sure that business is accountable for its actions, and initially environmentally and now socially. And so this domain is very interesting personally to me. When I had the opportunity to join our supply chain group to advance some of the more social issues, I bumped into this agenda more deeply and came across the work of John and others. And I think In thinking about the sorts of remarks I might make at a conference like this, I did them before I read the book, and then I read the book, and all the ideas were already in there. And what that tells me is I'd sort of institutionalized them along the way. And I think that happened throughout the period of John's mandate, that any business that was engaged in the process, as well as other organizations, governments and NGOs and others, kind of absorbed them so that they were so easy to accept by the end that there was no contest. And I think in that absorption, there has to have been a difference. And in my own company and on our own industry associations, you've seen actions where we've reflected on the guiding principles and the themes in them. We've integrated them into refreshes of policy and into codes of conduct. So I would say the beginnings of us internalizing those principles has started to happen, especially for those businesses who absorbed much of the message along the way like we did. So I think in the sense that business globalized around the 90s, I think it is true to say that corporate accountability or responsibility isn't yet globalized. And I think that the guiding principles have the potential to be the foundation for that globalization of corporate accountability. We are not there yet, but it is making a difference, I think.
Okay. Chris, I don't know, we haven't spoken for 35 years, but apart from that, we haven't spoken in advance of this meeting to talk about whether what role Chris would play, but whether you're comfortable reflecting on the human rights NGO responses to John's work,
yeah,
and the spectrum of that response.
Yeah, you know, those of you who followed John's work over the years know that he was extremely successful in getting governments on board. Not immediately, took a lot of work, and I think some governments were difficult. Extremely successful in keeping most of business on board. Again, not easy, and he certainly didn't pander to business. NGOs is probably the most difficult of the three, as NGOs tend to be. And I think most NGOs over time I think, came to understand what John was doing and came to accept John's assurance to them that John didn't see the guiding principles as the end game. He saw it as an extremely important first step to set up a framework and then for that to be built upon in the future. And as those of you who have been around the United Nations know, that's how things usually happen. That there's an instrument at the beginning, but it doesn't tend to be the treaty or the final end game. So I think over time, I think a lot of NGOs came on board, and there were a few NGOs that even loaned some of their prize staff to John and his team. And then there were other NGOs that, you know, the role of a human rights NGO is sometimes to really hold out, and I think some did. But even in those cases, I think John and those NGOs had a good working relationship, and by the end of the mandate really understood one another. And I think some of them at the end issued some supportive statements and comments. So it was a little bit of a mixed bag, and I don't know if you want me to discuss now, but I think one of the most exciting things going on at the moment in terms of implementing the guiding principles is what's being done by some human rights NGOs in the Global South, which is quite interesting, given that most NGOs in the Global South 10 years ago, the private sector was not on their radar. They had their hands full looking at their government's human rights record and abuses. It's really exciting seeing Global South NGOs turning their attention to the private sector, and a number of them are now using the guiding principles in their work. If I can mention just a couple examples.
No advertising.
Well, no. But one is a Chinese NGO that's been working with the Chinese textile industry. And they've just issued this report with non-judicial grievance procedures, a sort of framework for Chinese textile factories to use the guiding principles so that grievances are aired and something that could have mushroomed out of control is caught in the very early stages. And the guiding principles are explicitly used in that framework. Another NGO in Cambodia, the Cambodian Center for Human Rights has launched a business and human rights project where they're encouraging garment factories to incorporate the guiding principles into their business models. And what I like about this NGO in Cambodia is that they first sit down and actually directly engage with the garment companies. And they present the guiding principles and encourage them to adopt the principles into their policies. If the garment factory refuses to do so, then the NGO launches campaigning, drawing attention to the abuses at that particular garment factory. So the guiding principles are, you know, John's book gives a number of examples of how they're being implemented in many ways, shapes, and forms. For me, the most exciting thing is how they're being implemented by NGOs in the Global South, sitting down with Global South companies. So it's not John Ruggie, you know, or somebody from Geneva coming in, but it's the actual local advocates who are pushing the guiding principles in many countries.
Is it too soon to ask about Bangladesh? Those of you who are elderly like me and still read newspapers will have seen an article in the New York Times this morning which was pretty fascinating in terms of the responses by a range of different corporate actors to the tragedy that has claimed so many lives there. Do you know of any NGOs in Bangladesh that have been working on these issues? Have they made use of the guiding principles, or we just don't have that information yet?
We've been looking closely at that case. Mm. I don't know about the connection of the guiding principles being explicitly used at the moment, but I do know that it's a good example of the big brands who source from that factory in Bangladesh. you know, did any of them do their due diligence? As a lot of you know, one of the main provisos of the guiding principles is companies have to do their due diligence on human rights. A garment, an apparel company has to look at its suppliers and has to look carefully at the risk, the human rights risks that are undertaken in setting up a relationship with a certain supplier. Now, you know, I would be willing to bet anybody in this room that the big brands in this case did not do their due diligence with that particular factory.
Right. I mean, I think the difficult issue there, maybe we can get to it later, of course, is the pushback was that the factory had been inspected, I think, but that they didn't do structural inspections to make sure that it wasn't going to fall down. And so the question there is, can you really push that, you know, range of functions back or up to international actors? But Mike, turning to you, maybe an unfair question. Mike founded one of the biggest human rights NGOs in the country, one of the most influential, but for the last 4 years has been in the Obama administration. I'm just wondering what sort of, if there was any pushback that you got in your previous job as Assistant Secretary of State from any of the actors in relation to the guiding principles exercise? Or were they all happy? And if they are, I'm worried.
No. First of all, let me just say, just adding to what others have said, that what John has done here has opened up a lot of space in a range of areas. And we're all indebted to him for really setting the table. But as he said, this is really the end of the beginning of a conversation, and I think we're all aware of that. There were plenty of people in the U.S. government that I dealt with on a regular basis who were nervous of this entire conversation, and nervous in particular about, not so nervous about the state's duty to protect, although I want to talk about that even in the Burma context, because I think the U.S. should be doing a lot more, but very reluctant to push companies that were particularly American companies beyond what was really a traditional agenda. Traditional agenda was to promote exports, to promote American brands in the global marketplace, and to some extent to engage in the kind of traditional corporate social responsibility, private-public partnerships. You know, build an AIDS clinic in Soweto, you're helping humanity. All those things are perfectly fine. But there was a reluctance when you got to the question, for example, of Bangladesh, when Disney Company says they're walking away, they're leaving the country. I think that's the wrong decision. There's no discussion within, there's no push from the United States government to say to every American company that's in Bangladesh, get together and take responsibility for what's going on in those factories. There's not a discussion about Walmart, which says we're going to put $1.5 million into fire inspectors. That's a drop in the bucket for Walmart. It doesn't solve the problem. And with due respect to what Chris said, you know, the notion even of doing due diligence assumes that somehow you're going to go into a particular factory and discover or not discover what's going on. The fact is the whole system needs to be looked at in a different way. And those are the discussions that not only the U.S. but other governments are very reluctant to do. It's a model of sourcing that goes from one country to another looking for the cheapest way to produce. And almost inevitably, you're going to have human rights problems. So last comment that comes back to John. John's done a terrific job, again, of setting the table, of saying that there is this primary duty of governments, duty to protect, but then a responsibility of companies to respect, and trying to figure out what that means definitionally, how it's going to be set up structurally, where the remedies really are, and then how it applies operationally in a place like Bangladesh. That's the next chapter of this, and I think we're going to have a lot of interesting discussions.
I guess the main response to you is going to be competition. In other words, you call on we Americans to do all this in Bangladesh, but what about those damned Europeans? And if the Europeans are not going to move as well, then the Chinese are going to move in. So how the hell can you want we Americans to do it?
Yeah, you know, I have no doubt, and this was a lot of the conversations I had when I wasn't, you know, pushing with our own government, was to try to get Europeans, Japanese, others to really come in a collective response. There needs to be that collective response. I think it's going to be a while before we get the Chinese or maybe the Russians involved, but there certainly ought to be an EU, US, Australian, Japanese kind of a response that both pushes governments like Bangladesh to do the right thing, but also recognize that it's a very, very poor country. They don't have the resources to do everything. So we both have to be pushing, and we have to be assisting, and we've got to be pushing our own companies to take this up as a matter of priority. And really, where we go beyond simply saying, you know, due diligence, do no harm, we really need to say there have to be some standards here, concrete standards that are measurable that companies are held against.
Okay. John, China is a big issue here in terms of competition, China more active itself in external corporate activity and so on. Did you make any headway with the Chinese in your mandate?
Well, it depends what you mean by headway. Chinese delegation in Geneva followed the process very closely. They didn't say very much the first couple of years. Present at all consultations, taking notes, trying to figure out where this was going to go. At a certain point, and now I'm paraphrasing liberally, I had a discussion with a senior official who said to me, essentially, and here's where the paraphrase is, we're okay with you talking about foreign companies in China. We're okay with you talking about Chinese companies overseas. Just don't talk about Chinese companies in China. And I said, gee, 2 out of 3 isn't bad. I'll take it. They ended up voting for the guiding principles. Chinese companies and the Chinese government, I think, are still obviously in a very different space or a different place than certainly the European governments and European companies. But I'm hopeful that this is as much of a learning curve lag as it is a fundamental policy difference, because the Chinese government is desperately worried about instability at home, from mine explosions, from buildings collapsing, et cetera, et cetera. And so this is something that they also are closely following. To see what it is they can adopt domestically. The term human rights is still, you know, a challenge for China because of its association with civil and political rights and the privileges of the regime. Corruption is still a major problem. So we have a long way to go with China, but in terms of the immediate relationship with the mandate, it's as I described it, 2 out of 3.
Okay, sounds good. We're going to take questions. I'll go for another 10 minutes maybe, and then questions from the audience. So feel free to start thinking of who you want to attack. I mean, question. I think the most important thing really from here is where John's book ends. He says this is the end of the beginning of the next phase. And the question is where we go from here. We don't have a radical NGO perspective here, so let me do it. I really am playing devil's advocate here. I wouldn't be on the board of Shift. I wouldn't consider John to be a good friend and an admirer of his work if I endorsed this fully. But I think there's something in it. So the radical critique would be that there was a lot of anger out there, a lot of energy by NGOs and many others. They were mobilizing, etc. There was a chance that they were going to demand legal instruments, going to really hold companies to account in a fairly tough way. John has come in and smoothed it all over and said, look, we've just got to take this very slowly, step by step. I'm going to put a basic document in place. That, however, has sucked the oxygen out of the movement. It has put in place a sort of, a 50-year plan that maybe in 50 years we can, or 100 years, we can expect a significant number of corporations to be really following this. And so, in fact, in some ways, you've undermined us unless you really can point to a next step. And when we look to the UN has taken a move which is not encouraging in some ways. The creation of a working group is a good thing, but one of the dynamics of having five people having to fight everything out is that there's much less ability to exercise the sort of leadership that John exercised so effectively. So where are the next steps? You finished your book by saying, well, I was always asked about a binding legal instrument, and you have quotes from your various reports saying, this is the next step, we should be looking at that, and you compare it, I think, to the corrupt practices, legislation, and so on. What are the prospects, and most importantly, who are the drivers of that now that you're off the scene? Well, off that scene.
It's a good question. Let me do my best in engaging this radical NGO. First, I guess I would say when I started out on this process, it was about the time that the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples was nearing adoption by the General Assembly. And that declaration addresses one set of issues of one type of human rights holder. It took 26 years to negotiate, and it was not legally binding. So I said to myself that somebody ought to be doing this, but what do we say to people who need us between now and 26 years from now on a non-binding declaration that addresses one group, one rights holder? That's how I would begin the conversation. Not that this is not a great thing to do, and go ahead and somebody do it. But that's not going to solve the problem that I've been asked to address. I guess the second thing I would say is that the guiding principles are not simply a piece of paper, because they have already been incorporated in national legislation, including legally binding legislation, including in the United States. Mike can address, Section 1502 of Dodd-Frank. He can address the reporting requirement on American investors in Burma, et cetera, et cetera. The European Union is in the process of adopting disclosure requirements that exceed Dodd-Frank 1504, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So it isn't that there was simply a piece of paper that was left hanging out there, because from the beginning we worked with other standard-setting bodies. The OECD has a complaints mechanism. It has a human rights chapter now that is directly drawn from the guiding principles. Groups on the ground are bringing, from the Global South and elsewhere, are bringing cases against companies under these new provisions. So it isn't simply a piece of paper. It already is embedded in various institutions across the world. Not as much as I would like to see, but it's only been less than 2 years. We need to build on this. I guess the final thing that I would say is that obviously, you and I, we collaborated on a Supreme Court amicus brief in the Shell case with the NYU Clinic, and I was very happy to do that. We had an enormous impact. The Supreme Court,
that's why Kyobel came out so well.
We scared the hell out of them, right? The case went up initially over corporate liability. They didn't go anywhere near the issue. They were afraid of us, Philip.
We better start working on extraterritoriality.
That's the next chapter. You asked, what's the next chapter? The next chapter is we work on extraterritoriality.
Okay. So I guess the question to each of the three panelists before we open it up is, what's going to drive significant progress forward from here on? What's the corporate sector going to need, Zoe? Are we going to need to wait for more Bangladesh-type disasters that will focus the mind? Do we want Mike's governmental interlocutors to say, can we convene meetings in DC of you leading corporations? What's going to make the difference?
So I think the success and the remaining challenge of the principles are exactly in the integration in other instruments. And I frankly find it miraculous that it's been integrated already into so many things, as John just mentioned. And that's how it will hit business. When I think about a skeptic might read the document and say, so somebody wrote something, is a business actually going to do anything differently? Especially one that doesn't really have a brand, might still be big enough to cause some significant harm, but so. And I think to get to that layer of business that is underneath the tip of the iceberg of business that is watching this at the moment, to get to those, you are going to have a range of policy instruments, both market-based and legal-based, that level the playing field for everybody, enable us to compete, and at the same time, both as business respect our responsibilities and for the states to do their part too. And I think one thing that I think business does, that I would encourage any business people in the room not to, is only to read the section of the principles that concerns the business responsibility. Because in fact, the impact on business may well come from an expansion of the state duty and the subsequent implementation of other instruments such as corporate reporting, disclosures, and whatever. And so I think business needs to be thinking holistically about the range of measures, but it will be in the complementary nature of those measures hitting all types of companies all over the world, which is where this will be successful. And so for me, the key is that continued integration and continued consolidation and efforts by all industries, all levels, to make sure that they are taken seriously and not just a piece of paper in a UN library.
Great. Chris?
I think NGOs, the guiding principles doesn't make it easier for NGOs in a sense. It means they just have to work harder, and they need to expose governments that aren't living up to their right to protect. They need to expose companies that aren't doing any due diligence at all. Most companies, most CEOs around the world have never heard of the guiding principles as of today. There's really a long way to go. The great news, and I think one of John's greatest achievements, is that the principles were adopted by consensus. So no region and no country objecting to their endorsement. That's quite remarkable, and it prevents any company from hiding behind an argument that their culture or their region or their country doesn't accept the guiding principles. That gives the NGOs a real tool. But I think, if companies and governments don't move and move fairly soon, NGOs have a pretty good argument that this isn't working, and that is a good argument that the international regime has to move toward harder law and regulation. So I see companies perhaps being a little bit on the defensive, but NGOs are going to have to work hard and call them out, not at conversations in Geneva, but actually on the ground in terms of them not following through with due diligence. I wanted to close on one more point. What I see as one of the largest challenges, and this is sort of stepping back. some of the NGOs we've talked to, when we, you know, get into discussions about the guiding principles or about corporate accountability in general, their biggest worry is what they refer to as the corporate capture of government. And until that's addressed, the guiding principles are really going to have an uphill battle. By corporate capture of government, they're referring to at least three different things. Number one, that in many countries, the government or the royal family or the military actually owns the company. So how do you have the government doing its job to protect the very companies that it owns and is profiting from? Number two is what's called the revolving door, where people from certain industry sectors, the same people, go from the companies into the regulatory bodies of government that are regulating the very company they just came from, and back and forth.
But where would that possibly happen?
And where would number three possibly happen, which is companies contributing to political campaigns, which is another part of the corporate capture of government. You know, if some of these fundamental issues aren't addressed, you know, in Eastern Europe, in India, and in the United States of America, the guiding principles are really going to have a very difficult time in terms of governments really following through on their duty to protect and companies on their responsibility to respect.
Great. Mike, same question to you with the addition, should the UN Working Group try to start considering complaints? In other words, actually tackle major allegations that are brought to their attention and try to do something about them?
I think one of the challenges for the working group is going to have several agenda items that I think are important. One is going back to something I said earlier, which is to broaden and to be more specific about the definition of these terms. It's a good thing, but it's also a cautionary sign that there was unanimous support for the guiding principles. When you start to get into specifics by industry, by specific kinds of issue, you're going to have, if you don't have some controversy and some pushback, then we're not really moving forward. So I think it's going to be up to the working group to begin to think, what do you mean when you say responsibility, respect? If it's not legally binding, can it still be mandatory? And if it's not, what does that mean? Is every industry going to define its own terms? I think not. It has to be done. And then the second piece, which is what you just raised, is the question of remedy. And I think one of the key elements, the third key element of John's framework, is that you don't have a right without a remedy. And so where violations occur, what are you going to do about it? And one possibility is to bring some of that within the UN. I think that's the challenge there, frankly, is the scope of what we're dealing with is so massive. It's a little bit like the treaty bodies, you know, getting tens of thousands of complaints, which you know well, and really having the capacity to only act on a few hundred. So you don't want to create expectation and not be able to address, but maybe there are symbolic cases or situations you do take up. And that, to me, is the third piece for the working group. I think they ought to be, you know, looking at Burma, looking at Bangladesh, looking at the Russian-Chinese idea of information security, trying to limit internet. Pick some big issues, tough issues, and put those on the table. Those will clearly not be consensus exercises. But I think if there isn't some, I don't think there's going to be one answer here, but some combination of a robust international debate, pushing governments, the governments like the U.S. and Europe, to be more aggressive, both with governments that are not doing what they should, but also with their own industries, and the NGO media response. There has to be a public debate about these issues if we're going to move forward.
John, if you'd stayed on, would you have the same sort of prescription as Mike, that the process needs to become more adversarial? Or would you have continued to try to manage a consensual progression?
Well, my process was done. I mean, it finished with the adoption of the guiding principles. So a new process had to be created.
But do you agree that it has to be somewhat adversarial?
Does it have to be adversarial? The process itself, I addressed the issue of at one point of whether there should be a global ombudsperson, for example, an office in the UN that could take complaints. And we did some looking into that at one point. The resourcing issues are such that I drew the conclusion that it would be largely a symbolic exercise at the level of the UN. My budget when I started as special representative for business and human rights was 3 round-trip tickets between Boston and Geneva and a half-time person in the office of the High Commissioner. That's the budget that I was given.
That's a scandal. I only got 2 round-trip tickets.
You only got 2. So there are limits to what you can accomplish with these kinds of mechanisms. I ended up, as I think you mentioned, raising a fair amount of money from friendly governments, not corporate money, but government money. And it turned out that at the end, I had raised more money than for all other UN human rights procedures combined. Yeah. And it wasn't that much.
Do you want to give us the figure?
It was $15 million.
Right.
Yeah, that's not a big amount of money to address the problems of, the global challenge of business and human rights. So the idea that you can sort of create the global ombudsperson and adequately resource it, and there's 88,000 multinational corporations in the world. They have 800,000 subsidiaries. There's millions and millions of contractors and subcontractors. And you're going to establish an ombudsperson, and you're going to solve the problem. I don't see it. Where pressure should be brought to bear, and the international system can help leverage it, is on national governments, right? Mm-hmm. So we have this complaints procedure in the OECD, right? It requires that governments establish an office in national governments to take complaints. If that process says that a company was in violation of the guidelines, what happens? Nothing. That company can go next day and apply for investment insurance or export credit from the same government. That's absolutely absurd. So the disconnects within national governments, even in countries that pride themselves in their human rights support, let alone Bangladesh, right? I mean, 2 dozen members of parliament in Bangladesh are factory owners, right? So there is no silver bullet. We've got to fight this on many fronts, and adversarial challenges obviously have always produced change, social change. Where does social change come from? Right? It was the workers in the satanic mills, as they were called in the Industrial Revolution, who pushed. It was NGOs, civil society organizations, churches, who took up their voices and their causes and pushed. Union organizers, labor unions, political parties. There is no magic wand. It's a challenge on multiple fronts. If this has made any contribution at all, it is to provide a common framework, a common discourse, and a set of initial measures that governments and businesses have begun to adopt that I hope will have the cumulative effect of contributing to a solution, even though it is obviously not a solution in and of itself.
Great. So questions from the audience. Microphone, how are we doing this? We're going to take that around?
We're going to put it in the middle of the room.
Okay. So why don't you come down and
David Schilling from the Interface Center on Corporate Responsibility. Comment sort of picking up on what Mike said about we need something new, and a question for Zoe. So first, a bit of confession. Our organization helped to create this code monitoring system that hasn't worked, right? Even those that have done it really well and have evolved, there's still a lot of gaps. And I think the old human rights due diligence system was establish the policy, do the monitoring, but it's always of the supplier. You're not looking at integrating what you're learning about the assessments, if you will, into your own core business. So I think, Mike, you're absolutely right. To me, it's like the old due diligence was the more superficial code monitoring, and it did a certain level of due diligence. But I think the new system has to start with the buying companies, the retailers and brands, to look carefully at their purchasing practices, to help build capacity. I mean, I just learned that last year in Bangladesh, year 2012, 232 factories were inspected by government officials, and there were about 12% found to be unsafe. 232, there are 5,000 factories just in the apparel industry, so the capacity in terms of governments as well as companies and trade unions needs to be built.
So, question?
But the question for Zoe, I mean, part of it is, isn't there, what happens when you get to the factory level, there's a lot of balancing between ethical sourcing and the whole question of the price. So, Zoe, are there human rights criteria that need to be built into the pricing process? Because so much of the business model that goes, you know, race to the bottom is there aren't those kind of criteria, and it's just really about, you know, quality and delivery and the lowest price.
Okay. Thanks. Zoe.
Hard to disagree that it's not essential to have something like that. And in fact, as I was listening to the discussion, thinking about what my understanding of the guiding principles is, it speaks about your responsibility to do that due diligence and to act on findings. And I think acting on findings, it does not preclude organizations from incorporating criteria that is related to human rights or other social matters into their procurement decision making. And indeed, many of the sort of standards that are emerging, advanced through organizations like SAI and others, and the FLA and the others, they encourage corporations to look at your own practices. As John put it in a letter to the New York Times, I think, you know, to look in the mirror at yourself, the time has come to do that. And I fully support that, and we are looking at doing that, and I would definitely encourage other companies to do the same, because you're absolutely right. It's the acting on the findings is perhaps the next wave, and maybe we need standards or more discourse around what that looks like. But I don't think the guiding principles per se preclude you from doing that. In fact, I think it's fully embedded within it.
Mike?
Yeah, if I can just jump in on that. I think, David, a couple of things you said are right, but I take exception on one thing. It's absolutely clear that the idea of monitoring by itself is not enough. It's also true that it's important for every company to know by what standard it's going to be evaluated, and that there be a serious look at what benchmarks are, and that there be clarity about what compliance or non-compliance is. And non-compliance has to have consequences. And so that's the first point. Monitoring's not enough, but it sets a framework. Then once you figure out something's non-compliant, then the next question is, how do you change it individually? And to me, in some ways, the most important thing is, how do you get companies that are fierce competitors to begin to operate in a more collective space? That's what's going on in Bangladesh. Everybody wants to do a pilot project. Everybody wants to put out a press release. When you say to companies, let's sit down and try to figure out how to deal with these issues collectively and even change the model of how we source, that's when you run into problems. And that's where I think governments like the U.S. have to play a role, because companies are reluctant to get there.
Yeah.
Dominic Renfrew, the International Network for Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights.
If you could just speak into the mic, that would be great.
should be a bit shorter.
On your knees.
Dominic Renfrey from the International Network for Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, ESCNet. Professor Ruggie, if I could ask you to imagine a scenario where the next chapter, as you put it, extraterritorial regulation, becomes what we all hope it will be, what would that look like in your appraisal? And to ask you to be even more dreamlike, one of the challenges with the interpretation of where we see the benefit of the guiding principles is that in many different national contexts, we see them being implemented in many differing and varying ways. Unfortunately, for the radical NGO, if you like, it doesn't get at the point of how companies evade accountability by shifting resources, shifting through their legal corporate veil and the legal personality problems. So do you envisage at all that there's a future in a global scheme of binding regulation that can help us address those issues? And if so, what would it look like? Sorry, and previously on the first point of ETOs, do you see a role for the Maastricht principles on ESG rights at all in that? Thank you.
I see a role legal instruments at all levels, global as well as national. We put out a proposal to governments at the time that we submitted the guiding principles to consider negotiating a legally binding instrument addressing conduct that sort of rises to the level of international crimes as a first step. One of the challenges that we faced in the Human Rights Council is that the few governments that responded positively to that didn't want it to take place in the Human Rights Council. It was a very technical argument. They wanted it in New York, et cetera, et cetera. In any case, we got very little traction with it. I repeated the proposal in the final chapter of the book. My sense is that at this point in time, to have a global legally binding instrument across the entire spectrum of human rights that has any prospect of being adopted by governments, given their very diverse situations and interpretations of these issues, wouldn't succeed. But I thought it was critical to begin with the worst, which is why we made the proposal that there be an instrument that makes it very clear that not only individuals can be held liable for conduct that amounts to internationally recognized crimes, but so can legal persons, that is to say corporations. I've supported that all along, and I continue to support it. I forgot what the second question was. What about the Maastricht principles? Sorry, I missed it.
I think we did it the other round, sorry. Yeah.
I think getting a global legally binding instrument across the entire range of economic and social and cultural rights, I think, would be extremely difficult at this point in time. It can be done. It should be done in the area that, as I said, conduct that rises to the level of international crimes. With regard to piercing the corporate veil, extraterritoriality, I think the targets have to be key national governments at this point. In the final chapter, I speculate that the final chapter was submitted last September or October, I believe, and I speculated on how Kiobel might come out. And it wasn't far off the mark. And I said that would be a bad thing in the short run for business and human rights. But there is also a potential upside, if one can describe it in that way. Namely, that up to now, countries that are quite supportive of human rights, Canada, the Netherlands, the UK, have been able to resist domestic pressure for legislation with extraterritorial effect by saying, oh, look, it's in American courts, it's in the ATS, right? The Alien Tort Statute, they're, you know, Shell is being sued. What's the problem? And at the same time, they get to file amicus briefs complaining about the fact that their companies are being charged in American courts. So they get to have it both ways. Having the Kiobel decision come out the way it did, it's not a good thing for business and human rights, but one thing that it may well change is the political dynamic that has allowed governments to be hypocritical about this. And so the focus, in my view, ought to be on a number of key national governments that can no longer resist the pressure of domestic constituencies by saying it's in American courts.
Good. Next question.
Hi, thank you. Can you hear me?
Can people in the back of the room hear?
I'll try to speak louder.
Yeah.
Okay. Hi, I'm Gina Cosentino. I work with the Nature Conservancy, and I run our global work with indigenous people around the world. And I have, the charge to try to incorporate best practices, human rights standards in the conservation work that we do. So this is actually a very self-serving question, because I definitely need some guidance. Given that the Ruggie principles, and it's something that I champion throughout the Conservancy, and we're one of the world's largest conservation organizations, this means that we have a very high responsibility. We're duty holders, but there's that framework gap. The Ruggie principles apply to corporations. Do you think there might be a time when there might be a framework more established for NGOs, so that we're clearer on our responsibilities, our level of, our threshold, and what that should mean? So right now I'm using various frameworks. I use your Ruggie principles. I met with John Knox, who's the UN representative for human rights and the environment, and that was one of that was a piece of advice he gave to me. He says, well, you can start with the Ruggie principles. But I think for people like me who are championing human rights work in the conservation movement, having clear guidelines and having something that you can say to our CEOs and board members, we have some clear guidance here.
The question is, should there be a Ruggie principles equivalent governing NGOs?
Yeah, what that would look like.
Right, okay.
The second question, if I may, has to do with...
If you're fast, you may.
Given that 80% of the world's biodiversity exists on indigenous lands and waters, that means that we have corporations on there, oftentimes doing some very egregious things. When I meet with corporations trying to have them improve both their environmental practices and social best practices, and I refer to the Ruggie principles, they say, well, the standard of how we should be acting, for example, FPIC, free, prior, and informed consent, it's not really there. We don't really have certain obligations to indigenous peoples. Are you working potentially with James Anaya, UN Special Rapporteur James Anaya, to maybe fill that gap a bit to provide some clarity on indigenous rights and the Ruggie principles?
The first question I actually would defer to Chris and Mike. They're much better equipped to address.
It wasn't that hard, was it, John?
I'm nervous about the concept of principles for NGOs. This is a discussion that's gone on for a long time. We spend a huge amount of time trying to deflect mischievous governments that would like to use NGO laws and laws on association to constrain and restrict NGOs. It doesn't mean that there ought not to be standards and there ought not to be integrity in the way they operate, but I think we put ourselves at great risk, especially in this environment where you've got the Russians and the Egyptians and many others very, very keen to do exactly, they would love that proposal and they would run in a very different direction than you're talking about.
Chris, do you want to say? No. On Jim Anaya, he actually has put out a couple of reports recently relating indigenous rights to the UN guiding principles and seeing whether the indigenous rights issue can be pushed forward using the guiding principles, and it looks very fruitful.
There's also there's a standard clause in all human rights treaties, basically, which says that nothing in this treaty should be interpreted as warranting a lower standard than is required by other obligations. And so that's the effect with your report, that your report doesn't replace any higher standard that might be being put forward in, say, Anaya's report on Indigenous. Okay.
Hi, Stephen Thompson. I'm a student here at the law school. I wanted to follow up a little bit more on Kiobel and the post-Kiobel world that we have here, specific from the other direction, coming from the ground up, I suppose. Do you see any courses of action, judicial or legislative, that can be pursued post-Kiobel towards extraterritoriality, towards corporate accountability, or does it need to come from that higher, more policy level, as opposed to from the more grassroots ground judicial or legislative level?
John, can I interrupt? Can we take the next three questions as well, if that's all right, just because time is running out, so if we get all the questions on the table, and then we'll have a last round. Please.
Jeannie Meyer from the International Commission for Labor Rights, which is an international network of lawyers, labor lawyers around the world. I was interested because I'm doing a study on precarious work and how precarious work is clearly has problems, impacts the issues of freedom of association and right to collective bargaining. But in the principles and the human rights instruments that are incorporated into the principles, you have so many of them that do incorporate the fundamental principles of rights at work and the right the UDHR, the ICCPR, et cetera, and it seems to me that all of those which have overwhelming majority ratification status at a certain point do become binding customary law or potentially use cogens, which would actually give lawyers like us some handles in national courts. And so I'd like to at least have you comment on whether there's any way, whether or not you thought of at least raising these issues to the issue of use cogens or talking in those terms or not.
Okay, thanks.
An entirely different question, but same constituency. Eileen Kaufman from SAI. First, I just want to thank Mike because they're funding our work in the guiding principles. Its former employer is funding work we're doing to train on the guiding principles. My question, though, is about governments. I was very struck when I went to a meeting you had in Geneva that presented the way governments have the same problem individual corporations do. Individual corporations, we often talk about the conflict between the compliance department or the human rights department or the ethical department and the purchasing department and their different incentives. And it hadn't occurred to me until I went to that meeting that, of course, the same thing is true for governments. There's an Export Promotion Council, and then there's a labor ministry. And so my question is, is anything interesting going on in that space? Many of us here are working on the private space, but how about getting governments to be more coordinated?
Okay, different actors within government actually coordinating mm-hmm. their positions. What an outrageous proposition.
My name's Mike Fleshman, and for many, many, many years, I worked at the American Committee on Africa here in New York, and we were the folks that pushed an ultimately pretty successful corporate campaign to try to get U.S. private sector actors out of South Africa. And we didn't have the guiding principles back in those days. We had one of its grandfathers, the Sullivan principles. And I have to say, that was a real pain in the ass. It was a minor obstacle. It could have been a major obstacle had we decided to take it a bit more seriously. But it was absolutely defensive. Companies found themselves under much more public pressure than they had anticipated from grassroots campaigns that we and other organizations were pushing. And Reverend Sullivan, who sat on the board of General Motors, came up with his principles, and they all hid behind it for as long as they possibly could. I don't know about 2005, but it certainly wasn't the case that the U.S. government was sitting on the sidelines watching us and Version 500 battle it out.
What's the question that emerges then from
this? I guess my last question is, given that the guiding principles seem to have many of the same liabilities that the Sullivan principles have, the unenforceability and reliance on corrupt governments to enforce them. What did you take away from all of the other voluntary codes that preceded it? Because I really just don't see a great deal of difference.
Okay, so what lessons did the Reverend Ruggie learn from the Reverend Sullivan?
Keep religion out of this. It's hard enough already. Let me start with the last one. The guiding principles aren't like the Sullivan principles. The Sullivan principles is a private individual who came up with the idea of a certain code which he asked companies to sign on to. I haven't asked any companies to sign on to anything. This was an official, intergovernmentally charged process. The guiding principles were adopted officially by the United Nations Human Rights Council. They've been adopted by the Council of Ministers of the OECD. They've been adopted by the European Union in part. Legislation is being based on them. So there is no comparison between the guiding principles and the Sullivan principles. That was a pure individual voluntaristic effort. This was part of an official global policy process. As flawed as global policy processes are, this is how they work. And so there's the analogy is an inappropriate one. With respect to disconnects among government agencies, not only are they disconnected, but they sort of reflect governmental priorities. If you go into any national capital, including including inside the State Department, you go to the Bureau of Economics, and you think you're in corporate headquarters. You go to Mike's former shop, and you think you're in the third basement with with metal filing cabinets because they can't afford the wood veneer.
We're the last place in government to have Wang computers.
So how do you overcome the disconnect? Well, first you begin a conversation. You begin a conversation by saying, you know what? Investment treaties affect human rights. They allow companies to sue governments if governments adopt certain measures that change the economic equilibrium of an investment. That's a human rights issue. When we first introduced that idea into the Human Rights Council in Geneva, sort of jaws dropped because this is not a human rights issue, that's a commercial issue. Well, it is a commercial issue, but it's not just a commercial issue. It has fundamental human rights implications. The South African government, after adopting the Black Economic Empowerment Act, found itself sued by investors from Luxembourg and Italy on the grounds that this was tantamount to expropriation, because the Black Economic Empowerment Act required a certain number of majority population to hold stock, to be on boards, and to be employed. South African government said, how the hell did we ever get into this situation? Well, you got into this situation because you signed a bad investment agreement. And why did you sign a bad investment agreement? Because the people who negotiate investment agreements had never heard about human rights and had never connected the dots to the Black Economic Empowerment Act. Well, that conversation has begun. And you see in the recent most recent bilateral investment treaties, including the model bilateral investment treaty that the US government has put out, a need to safeguard domestic policy space, to protect labor rights, to protect the environment, and so on and so forth. So before the conversation began, those things were disconnected. Part of our mission was to begin that conversation. The EU has an advantage because they have the European Commission that can push dialogue into national governments, and they're adopting EU-wide standards that reflect some of these concerns. With regard to the post-Kiobel, at the moment things are incredibly murky. It was not a clear decision at all. I saw some some enthusiastic announcement from a business association. Well, now we have clarity and we know where we stand. There's absolutely no clarity here at all, except that there is a presumption against extraterritoriality and that mere business presence does not overcome it. No idea what mere business presence means or what more than a mere business presence is. No idea what a presumption is in the face of evidence of involvement by a company, et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, I once described the Alien Tort Statute as a full employment act for lawyers. My God, it's even more true after this decision than it was before. But the one thing that I think is becoming, certainly has become clear, is that the focus is going to be on the nationality nexus, whether it is whether you have to be an American company or whether you have to have a significant, whether part of the conduct that violates international norms is somehow associated with the United States with sufficient force, in the words of the Supreme Court decision. So the focus is going to be on nationality nexus, which brings me back to what my urging before, that in addition to folk to campaigning for global instruments, start campaigning in national capitals. Go to Oslo, go to The Hague, go to Ottawa, because they're good starting points, right? They claim to be leaders in human rights and in the rule of law, and go to Washington. And talk to Mike before you go, because he'll tell you where the landmines are buried. So the nationality nexus is becoming key. Focus on it.
Thanks. Time is running out, so quick comments from the remaining three. Mike, do you want to start by apologizing for not bringing coherence to all the U.S. government positions?
I plead the fifth. Just two things on a couple of the questions. On the coordination in government, it's obviously a huge challenge for every government, but there are a couple of places that we did some things when I was there and they're being done now. One is on private security contractors. There's a Swiss initiative now, which really looks to governments and the US government, in particular the UK, to be engaged and set standards and oversee the issue of private security contractors. We had all kinds of challenges and debates between state and the Defense Department, but that's about to come into online, and it's a really key one to watch. Second, is on the internet. We did have, and my colleague Sarah Labowitz was very involved with this, a cyber coordinator at state, Chris Painter. We did a lot to try to bring the various parts of the government dealing with internet freedom issues, security issues, privacy issues. That's a key space, and it's one that I think more needs to be done, but our government was doing it. And the last is, for internal purposes, we took very seriously the Universal Periodic Review, which is a look at the United States. We did it in 2010. It's coming up again next year. So for people who are looking at labor rights or environmental, whatever the issues are in the United States, discrimination, there really is an opportunity. There'll be consultations around the country with NGOs. It's only going to work if NGOs come and say, these are things we care about. It's critical. One of the things I think we're going to try to do at NYU at Stern is to bring European governments together to talk about not only how we coordinate internally within our governments, but broadly between us so that we have a shared agenda. Last quick comment on the Sullivan principles. People in this room like David Schilling, and Adam Kanzer work on in the investment side of things, which we haven't really talked about. Investment community, responsible investors look at environmental, social, and governance, ESG. There's a lot on the environmental side. There's a lot on the governance side. We really need to push the S, the social, barometers. Make them real, real benchmarks, real standards. That's something I think it's keen for us all to work on.
Thanks. Chris?
Yeah, referring back to the question about getting governments to be more coordinated, the United Kingdom government is very soon going to issue a roadmap on how it is planning to implement the guiding principles going forward. And it should be interesting. The sense is that it's going to be a pretty good report and very substantive. And what's unusual about it is in most cases, the UK Foreign Ministry would just write up a report, issue it, and then the problem would be that all the economic ministries in the UK would simply ignore the report. In this case, the Foreign Ministry is getting sign-off from all the economic departments. So when this is issued, which should be imminently, I would encourage all of you to take a look at it. And if it is a good report, I would encourage all of you to put pressure on European and North American governments and say, why aren't you, where's your roadmap? And what are you going to do to implement the guiding principles? The last thing I wanted to say was one anecdote. This is a case of a corporation using the guiding principles and undertaking due diligence in a way that really sort of took me aback. The good news is that it happened. The bad news is, why do I only have one anecdote of this nature? So this is a very large multinational company that was thinking of buying another large multinational company. But before doing so, they went to our website and looked under that other company's section to see all the positive and negative reports going back 10 years about that company's human rights record. And they didn't stop there. They then looked at, they did the same thing with the 40 largest customers of that company, because they would be inheriting those contracts. Went through the human rights record of every single one of those 40 companies. This is before making a decision, do we purchase or do we not? A very, very big decision for this company. To be undertaking that level of human rights due diligence is very, very impressive. And, you know, let's hope we get to the day where I have other anecdotes.
Zoe.
Yeah, I think maybe bringing it a little bit back to Bangladesh and other severe cases, and perhaps even our own experience in conflict minerals, where there are many, many actors of many types and sizes of corporations involved in sourcing from these environments. And although big brands are there, it isn't just those. And I think collectively, if we can find a way to talk to the people who we aren't already talking to, I think that would help us move this debate a little further. Simplifying what we expect of business and reaching out to the standards bodies and others to try to reach other types of corporations who at the moment will end up with the business that the big brands turn down. And that's what I fear, is that it won't penetrate deep enough, and I would encourage all of us to think about that.
Thank you, Zoe. Thank you to all our panelists. Thank you to Philip, our moderator. Can I invite you all to indeed express your thanks for a really rich discussion. Thank you to all of you for being with us this evening, for bringing your questions, and I hope keeping the debate going with all those interesting critical twists and turns. Another round of thanks, if you would. The usual people who are so often unrecognized that make an event like this happen. I'd like to give a shout out to Viola Opgenhafen from the Center for Human Rights and Global Justice, to Annabelle Short, Daniel Vince Archer, and Patty Surak at the Business and Human Rights Resource Center, and to our own wonderful Barbara Conneval at SHIFT, for helping to make this evening happen, bringing you all here and giving us a really rich occasion. So thanks to all of them. Now, ironically, it's the US launch of this book today, but we've been informed by the publishers that the first print run has already sold out. So you'll be, yeah, absolutely. So you'll be delighted to know that before that happened, we snagged some copies. If you don't yet have one, you can get one outside. And John is going to be exercising his right arm to sign as many as you would like. So that will all happen during a reception outside. The other thing I will do in a blatant plug, one of the papers I mentioned from SHIFT out this week is a discussion paper together with our partners at Mazar, auditing and accounting firm, for a project to develop global reporting and assurance standards on alignment with the UN guiding principles. It's a discussion paper with questions. We need comments. We need critical comments. So please pick up a copy and let us know your thoughts. Are we on the right tracks? Are we not on the right tracks? What ideas do you have for us? It's a two-year project. This is the starting moment. So please take that with you. Give us your feedback on that. And with that, enough from myself. I'm going to ask somebody to tell us where we're heading for those drinks you've been waiting for.